Last time I gave a presentation, my cell phone rang twice, so that's... You don't have to do that. It's just that it doesn't disturb me. So, this presentation is about creating custom interactive images. I was asked by the organization to if I wanted to give another presentation, and I was looking what I did the past year that would be interesting to talk about. And I made a tool to create custom ID images, but I first want to explain a little bit what they are, how they work, and then show you the tool and show you some things I made with it. I'm using Remote. This is another project. I try to promote it in every presentation I do, so if people went to one of my previous presentations, you probably saw me using it as well. And I'm going to showcase it a little bit. You can enable mouse mode, so you can move your mouse around. You can, well, in this case, you can, of course, go to your presentation, or you can go to the next workspace. It rumbles every 10 minutes, so that I know, so it takes a little bit every 10 minutes, so that I know how much time has passed. And shake one time after 10 minutes, two times after 20 minutes, so I also know, so I don't have to keep counting it. It shows you here how much, so far less beginning after 10 minutes, and let goes on, 20 minutes, and let goes on. You can also see, and it's very cheap. If you buy one of those presentation devices, you can easily spend 100 euros for a device like this, and this is only 25 euros or something. Even second hand, it's even cheaper. And it works on Linux, while some of these expensive ones, they have a closed protocol, and both one of the expensive ones, which was nice, it was the PCMCIA card standard. It was not a PCMCIA card, but you could put it in the slots, you could always bring it with you, but it didn't work on Linux, only on Windows, and it was difficult to find how it worked. I'm not a hardware specialist. But, yeah, so I don't know if there are other features. You can, of course, go to a full screen mode. What it does actually is it sends normal keyboard events. And what it does, it looks at what program in X has the focus, then reads out the name of the program. And based on that name, I have a mapping with all the keyboard events or everything you want to do. And so it works for different applications. Now it works for open office, but you can use it for MDAC or TV time. I use it for my TV system to go to the channels. You can use it for just going to Nautilus, browse through the file system. And with the mouse, you can of course also start applications and stuff like that. Yeah, it's actually very basic, but it works with all the applications that you write config files for. At the moment, it's hard-coded inside of the program, but we're going to make config files. I had to finish it, all the features I want for Frostcon. We made a live CD in CentOS in every conference room. I'm not using it, but there is an every conference room, there's a live CD in CentOS with all the presentation tools and this. And we bought these small Bluetooth dongles in the USB so that everybody can use it. So if someone here is going to give a presentation today or tomorrow, I'm very excited if you would like to try it before and use it during the presentation and tell me how it works and if you liked it and what you change or what you accidentally missed or something. Anyway, that's completely... I have some flyers here with some more at the boot. The closing CentOS boot also have the represent boot. If you want to know more, if you want to try it out and stuff like that. Okay. First, who am I? An independent Linux consultant. I used to work for some big companies and still work for a few big companies. Currently at a bank. I don't use that at the bank. I also am involved in a few open source projects. The important one is RPMforge because that was the first I started with. And now I'm also doing a repo. I don't know if people know this, but in CentOS you have additional RPM repositories, or at Enterprise Linux also can use these repositories. And RPMforge is more for multimedia, and repo is for hardware. So we try to add more drivers from the list kernels to the CentOS kernel, because CentOS kernel is the old kernel, but with these drivers, you can use CentOS even on desktops. And the funny story is that here at Frostcon, they have two screens. I think they promote they have a schedule of the presentations over there. And they tried Fedora, but it didn't have the network driver. They tried Ubuntu, and Ubuntu, the screen flicks, and they tried the CentOS Live CD, and the CentOS Live advisory work. So the level project, it really makes it easier to make hardware work in a sense. And I already had 10 minutes because I initialized it a little bit earlier. So I don't know if it's called what you're talking about. I've also done some other projects. These that I presented 2 years ago. I presented last year. Project I also presented last year. The other ones are less known and not as interesting to talk about. Now, the objective is, of course, that you understand what the initial RAM is. There's also a difference between an init ID and an initial inter RAM address. It's not as important, but I'll explain it. I will show you a little bit how you can look in, what's inside of them, and also how you can create them. And it's up to you to think of interesting stuff to do with it. So I think it's not that much used. It's normally used for booting your system, but not many people use initial RAM disk for something else. And I think you can do some specific things with it. I will show you also what I did with it. So, what is an initial RAM disk? Actually, I think it existed from the beginning of Linux, at least version 1. And it actually is used for booting a kernel that doesn't have all the drivers, or doesn't have drivers for your system specifically. So you have a default kernel that is built for the normal things it needs to do for booting, but then it doesn't do more than that. And so, most important use for an initial RAM disk is actually to load additional modules that you need and facilitate finding the root file system and maybe even do some other things that you want to do with the root file system. That's usually the only thing that you do in initial RAM disk. Of course, if you want to use a network file system, you need the network drivers and you maybe need another network file system or some other modules. So it depends a little bit on what you want to do, but normally you build specifically for the purpose of booting the system. But of course, it can also be used as a system itself. You don't need to mount the root file system. You can use the initial RAM disk as the complete system. You can make a live CD with just one initial RAM disk and a kernel. There are also examples of people who are doing it. If I go too fast, wait or something, because I always want to go too fast. Anyway, so what is there to prepare? If you want to find the root file system, I always said a little bit of things. You want to find, of course, your block device drivers. You want to be able to find the hard drive. You want to find the local volume management. If the root file system is the local volume management, you have software array that you may want to have to search for. If you have disk encryption, of course, it needs to be at that stage, otherwise the disk is not really encrypted. Booting from network files and drivers, all that stuff. Usually, I already said that, but usually, if you do install Linux, it will know what hardware you have and it will create a specific initial RAM disk for your hardware. So that Linux can boot on your hardware. If you update your hardware, usually you also have to, or you might have to, add some drivers to make it work. Especially if you move an existing Linux system from one hardware type to another hardware type, you often have to rewrite the initial RAM disk to include the drivers you need. And in some cases, because all these distributions have their own pool, in some cases, these tools use modprobe.conf to see what drivers it needs to include. Sometimes the hardware detection does it for you. Usually the modprobe.conf is written by hardware detection, so most of you know this. Now, the difference between initial RAM disk and initial RAM address, people still confuse both or use the name for both, it doesn't really matter. It's that since the 2.6 kernel, they added the initial RAM address driver, and it dynamically allocates RAM. So you don't have to, I don't know if people remember the old days, if you wanted to boot, you might have to add how big your RAM disk needed to be. So you had to give a number and hope that the RAM disk would fit in there. It's still allocated, and so you lost that memory forever. And with the initial RAM address, it's dynamically allocated, so you don't, it only takes up the space you need. And it's also a bit faster. It's a lightweight RAM address driver. there's also less opportunities where things can go wrong. So the new init run reverse is much better. There's also a different way of bootstrapping. In the old days, it would run the binary or shell script, which was called linux.sh. Now it's called slash init. And in the slash init, you decide what you want to do, what you need to do to find the root file system. Every distribution has their own script that looks for the root file system and loads correct kernels, and there are some attempts to standardize this, because if all distributions would use the same infrastructure, then of course it would improve for all the problems that are known. And now sometimes all distributions have to fix their own problems and have to find their own solutions for things. And as I said, init is the old one, init RAMFS is the new one. But as I said, maybe now it's the MK init RAMFS, I think. They changed the name of the tool. Red Hat still calls it MK init RAMFS. And if you have an initial run disk, how can you look at it? Well, it's actually a CPIO archive. It is compressed with gzip. And what you can do is you can, without always do is to see what drivers are in my initial run disk. I often need to know that to see if after reboot it will do what I expect. Or see if MK init took the drivers that I need. So what I always do is a set cut of the initial run disk so that it's compressed. Then I simply strings on it so that I remove all the bytes that I don't care about. And that gives me usually the scripts that's on the initial run disk and also shows me what drivers this load. But of course, you can completely uncompress it to your file system and look at the files individually. So this command does that for you. As I said, I have the Linux RC and init that's being executed. And in some cases, it's a normal shell. Usually, it's a very small shell. Usually, BusyBox is used to make initial run disk as small as possible. Red Hat has its own shell, which is a very weird shell. But it's very small, but it has some commands that are not in the real shell. It's also lacking some of the other stuff that the normal shell has. So, if you want to write scripts in Bash, have to have a completely different mindset. In principle, it doesn't matter what you use. You could make an initial run disk with Python on it, and you could run Python instead of using shell. So you can make a binary, you can make it very small. I think BusyBox has a default. I might be wrong. I thought BusyBox had its own shell script or shell binary. I'm not sure anymore. We can look at this important. So as I said, different distributions have their own way of enabling and disabling functionality. There is a project going on for making that standard. But you can create it by hand by just creating new inside of directory. You can put all the files that you need in your initial run there, and this command will list all the files, put them in the CPIO, zip them. It's that simple. The presentation is almost over, so this is all there is to it. It's very easy. You can play with it, and of course you will stumble over a lot of stuff because it's always still something that you have to add. And so yeah, you can play with it like this. So now comes the cool part, I think. I have to admit that for this creating this, the live CD, and I was up until 3 o'clock this morning, and at 7 o'clock I was again here to create USB sentiment on all systems and test it. So the demonstrations might, I don't know, let's hope for that. So let me first explain you what I wrote it in the first place for another project, but this is the course. So this I will do first and hope it works. We have a problem at the current customer where in big companies you have different teams. Every team has its own responsibility and doesn't know about anything else. And you have a team for racking systems and touching them. You have a team for configuring the network. You have a team to install the system with Linux, and you have a team that has to do the support for everything. That's me. So if something fails in one of these teams, it's always my problem because the installation fails. And solutions with the network, and everything that failed could help me. So it was very important for our team, the responsibility, they should be able to check if it was correct, and not to push on and then until then we get errors and we have to find what the cause was and then talk to the team, and the team said, yeah, but I don't see anything wrong, and they come back to us and we have to say, yes, sure, because this is what it says, and they still say, no, but it looks like fine and firewall. And big companies, it can take up 1 month before you get something wrong fixed, especially because the company I work for merged with Germany, and not because it's Germany. You have two countries, and it's very hard to instruct people from the other country to do something because there's different layers of people in between administration. So, I thought, why don't we make a simple tool that we can put, and that would simply do all the work. It didn't exist yet. I looked for it because it would save me some time. But what it does is actually it boots the initial parameters that are very small. It boots it via a CD that is being mounted via the KVM. We have a very cool KVM where you can mount into images. It will work with the IBM RSA, it will work with the base and all that stuff. So just an ISO image with lots of tools on it, and one of the tools is called Artadeep. Guess what my group is? This is video. Okay. I looked there, last year it was in the middle, and I said, ah, no video, that's fine. We have to beat this up and mask it. Maybe my face. Okay, so what we did then, so this tool was just simply put this very small image, I think it's 8 megabytes. It contains only the network drives, don't the drives for hard drive. That's why I said you could use a hard drive, but in this case, you don't need anything except network drives. Because the only thing we want to do is bring the network, see if I have a link. I don't have a link. It's already wrong. If I do have a link, then I try to copy the gateway. They don't open, it's a security risk, yeah? So RPing they cannot close, because if could they would do it, but RPing they don't close. So I can RPing my gateway, yes, okay, fine. If I can't, of course, there are multiple problems. It could be wrong IP address, wrong gateway, it could be that's the wrong VLAN, or it could still be a switch configuration where it's not really connected to a VLAN or something. So in that case, you still have to, at least they can try first to see if the patch is correct, and then the next team has to do their own stuff. To be honest, you can simply enjoy the next episode of it. So check if the interface is connected, if there's a link, and then it also tries to go with HTTP to do our distribution talk. We use SentinelOne, so if we just use our own to over HTTP, it's the only connection that we need. But if HTTP fails, RPing works, it's usually a firewall problem. Or the web server is down, of course, but that never happens. Did someone look? No. I'm hearing sounds. It's the sleep. You have to keep me awake. That's why I'm so fast, I have to keep myself awake. So, and that's what it does. Actually, it's very simple. I was going to talk 20 minutes about it, but. So, let's show it. And I tried it in a virtual box, but it doesn't boot, the kernel doesn't boot. So I find it really strange that the kernel doesn't boot in a virtual box because it's a standard rested kernel, well, 5, and in a virtual box it hangs somewhere. So it's possible that it's after the kernel, my scripts, I don't know. It's really strange because I don't do that fancy stuff. Stupid me. I should have used my. It works! So, I did prepare it a little bit, this one at least. So this is, normally it's an ISO file, and I can show you the ISO, it looks a little bit disturbing, but what I do is run KEMU, that's also what I use to test my ISO images. It's very fast for testing ISO images. It's not very fast to load the system, but that's not what I test. So I use KEMU with kernel. The nice thing about KEMU, you can also give it directly to kernel on the disk. You don't have to make ISO image, you don't have to make something media. You can just give it a curl around the skin, done with it. Here I say, well, I should probably make it bigger. And so yeah, look at that. So I need to promote it, I need to make you excited. So you can probably, well, I should, I can do that as well. So I look here. I don't know if yes. So I need to explain it maybe a little bit first.
I run
to use the serial and also to use on Zoom. And I figure my three different software devices. That's just a demonstration, right? So I have to start speaking very slowly to fill my next 30 minutes. Do you have questions? So let's go back to my other. Yes. Now, the real reason why I wrote this tool was for the sales project, I thought it would be nice to have a rescue image. There are, of course, very good rescue images on the internet, but it would have been nice if you have a rescue image that comes with a live CD or it comes with a normal CD. There's just one option by booting, and then you can just go into rescue mode. It would have the rescue mode that Redhat delivers because it's very minimal. It would contain all the programs I know that are useful in debugging. It would have views, DLS drivers, additional hardware drivers for LPO. It would include so many things. I have a list of all that. Actually, the reason why I wanted to do this as well is because I don't know if you know RIP Linux. Its recovery is possible. It's also a minimal initial run disk that has all these tools and also always the latest kernel. It even has a graphical environment, very lightweight, with Firefox. Well, if you click the icon, it will download it with all these extra additional tools that are downloaded. But the project announced that it was going to stop. And when they announced it, I said, I use it so a lot, so I want to have the same thing. I'm a CentOS guy, I was a CentOS guy. I thought, why not build it on CentOS? And so I wrote a small tool, and I called it AkaRootFS. And it creates an initial run disk based on your own system. So it's not specific to CentOS. Or you just say, you create a template, you say, this file I want to include, and you have a directory, this link to this template, where you list all the additional files you want to put on into the initial run disk. You can create your own initup and stuff like that. It will just grab all these things, and it will not only just grab all these things, it will also look what libraries are needed for running that binary. And then it will put everything onto the initial run disk, and it also compresses all the binaries and libraries with UPX. The tool compresses binaries and libraries, and they're still functional. And that makes it a little bit more, I think I saved 10 megabytes or something. So it helps. I want to call my salvation as possible. Recovery is sort of salvation. I can showcase that. I can show you the script. So I split this. I can show the script, but I don't know if it's worthwhile, but it's still the time. If someone wants to leave now, you're free to go. Let's see. Okay. I don't know how it works. So the AkaRootFS. Just go through it. Actually you call it by doing you can show SibLinux, and so I have a file set with the name SibLinux, which contains all the files I want to include. And I have a directory, which is also called SibLinux, with a complete tree of the additional files I want to add. And if you look at my file set, that's just a shell script, so it's not. I have for BusyBox, it's minimal, it's minimum, the smallest one that gives me a shell. I have a CentOS 5, I have a CentOS 5 minimal, and the SibLinux file set is, looks like this. So it's just a list of all the things I want to include. It doesn't contain libraries, because libraries are always secondary. Binary needs a library, so pull that library. You don't have to add manually libraries. This is how it looks. I do put something from lib in here, but there are some directories. For instance, I put up on it to install additional packages on it, and I also put RPM on it, because recovery RPM is necessary. Usually up, of course, contains additional files that you need for running up. And so creating this list, of course, is some work, but see what it includes. And then if you look at the directory, I think I call it scale root. And in scale root, in this case, you see, I have directory sublinux. So if I look inside of the scale root sublinux, then you can see, all of them, you see, I have my own custom for my rescue, I have an issue file, I have some cron directory empty, but I think I created it because it otherwise not created. I have a stop which is needed. It's not needed, but I think something complains if you don't have an empty one. And that's very simple, and you run it. Now, the problem is when I create the script, when I use the script, I was not prepared. When I created the script, it was a year ago on another laptop, and I reinstalled this laptop, and so I don't have all the tools listed in the file set on my system. That's what you're going to see. It says, cannot find the file, and all these files are missing from initial run script. The next thing is to add something that automatically installs the packages that contain these files, of course. Then it could become specific to CentOS because I have to use get or and that would then get yeah. It's too small. I really did it very low so that I knew when something was that I saw it. It's only 60 degrees or something. As soon as I do something, it will show me. Make complaints, but I have to fix this in my. Make the device that you need, create and directories that I need, and files, and then it makes the kernel module dependencies. So it looks for the kernel that you're going to use, and it looks for the it creates the dependencies onto my CPIO archive. Then it configures up because I want to be able to run up to these are the repositories I added. But this is of course custom. This is a custom script. Sending files because sometimes BusyBox puts them in a different location than originally, that the operating system expects. So I put them into the location where the operating system does expect them. And then it starts completing the line, and that takes 6 minutes. But I'm going to interrupt because it's still missing the binaries, and I am going to try and boot it, but. Don't kill me if it fails. Because then test it. And I should use the kernel that it originally came with. So I hope I put it here. Yeah, rip. I think it's no. Let's try. Let's see. Living on the edge. So let's try what happens with this one. Because the initial run disk, of course, contains kernel modules. These kernel modules are built for a specific kernel. So it doesn't match. If the directory doesn't match the run kernel, it won't find any. It won't find any. So you see that it checks if it can find the initial run disk, and if it finds it and it isn't the initial run disk, it can read it, then it will simply do it. And then it continues with booting. So then to my boot file system, that's not good. I don't know exactly why it does say that because it doesn't need to look for root file system. I mean, it has my initial run FS. Maybe it has a problem using that one. Ah, yes, of course. This is the one I just created, and it wasn't finished. I overwrote my sample. So. Do I still have it somewhere? Or I could just let it finish, but it takes 3 minutes to compress, so what shall I do? What shall I do? My brain says run, run! I think I have one here. No, this is the source code, not the final product. It works very well. It's amazing what it can do. Okay, I'm going to show you one more thing, and then I'm going to finish it. And if you really, really want to see this, we'll do it after. You can go to the represent boot. So I use an image to create, and I'm just going to show you because it has some interesting features, so maybe it brings you some ideas of your own if you're a system administrator. This is what you get if you boot the ISO image from the KVM. And let me put it full screen mode. If it works, it should work. Because, oh, yeah. Nice. So, what it actually does is it contains all the Anaconda installer from all different Red Hat Enterprise Linux releases. So, both 32 and 64. This ISO image created every time a new system needs to be loaded. So it creates a new ISO image and pushes it to the KVM automatically. So every time you create a web interface, a new system with all the features that you want, it will create all the new ISO image. It also pushes the VM ESX on a share. And you can also, if you want to boot a new created VM, you just select this ISO image, you will always have the latest. The ISO image contains a few tools, XDebug, RippleLinux, the Memdesk, and HDT. I don't know if people know this. This is a hardware detection tool. It's a tool written for SysLinux, or ISO Linux in this case. And hardware detection tool, it's like not a BIOS, but it's a hardware browser written in your bootloader. I don't know what will happen in the virtual box, but if I run hardware detection tool, there's a new version out. You get something like this. It's not booting in OS. It's in your boot mode. Runs this. And so this looks will be the next best thing for bootloaders because people are now writing programs for the bootloader so that you don't even have to boot an operating system to do something functional. And if you look at this, this is my virtual box. You can see I have in my virtual box these ID guides. I want to change this, but it's dark. I want to, because it's sometimes not so real, especially the KVM, it takes over the screen, it sometimes it's, the colors are a little bit off. But you can see for every device what you have. You have the processor, if you have multiple processors, it shows you how many, BIOS information, system information, new version has DMI information, so you could put, well, if you put information inside of the VPE, you can see the system or something like that. And it also has, and this is an old version, sadly, it also has, it maps the PCI ID. If you put the PCI ID's file onto the ISO image, it maps all your hardware with the module. And if you know from the bootloader what modules are needed, so the next thing that we are thinking of creating is making an initial run disk based on your hardware directly from the bootloader. Because that would be very, very cool. Of course, some of the things you don't know, LVM and things like that, you only know afterwards. But they're also writing ways to inspect your disk. Because I think maybe it's in there. It's in here. I should really do that. I should have. The new system also shows the partitions. The disk should have the partitions you have from the BIOS, of course, via the BIOS. And the next thing is also to write file system to read out file system and get some information from the file system. So, yeah, this looks really odd. I love it. So exit and you go back to the bootload. You don't have to reboot to go back to the bootload, which is also nice. And to show you what you can do, because I normally give the command line, so people just have to type the name of the machine and it will start to install. Now, because of course you also want to see what is listed, I made also a menu, and so you have the system load entries. And so for every system in here, these are old ones. For every system in here, let me see. You see that for every system in here, it says, for instance, this is an ESX installation, and it says how it needs to be loaded. And it also contains, and that's why I need to create an ISO image, because we cannot use this because it's a security problem, it's not about this. You have the IP here, you have the network here, gateway here, and actually, I told you that we wanted to order the drives in order that Red Hat loads them, but I actually lied to you. we forced an org. We forced this org for the portable device because in old Proton, in old IBM system, this one driver system all worked on, and new IBM system, this one is the worked one. So I'm always sure if I load these drivers at the beginning in this order, I will have the unboxed ones first ones. And then I say where to get the Kickstarter file. But I need to put the IP information in there because otherwise I don't have network access. And that's silly, but TCP is a security problem. You can see here what we include. We include every version since we did this. Also include some old ones. And it also includes VMware Elix. So we use the same, or you can use the same thing with Elix. They're not planning to use it anymore for Elix because Elix now has their own way of installing systems. And then you have lots of extra tools for Syslinux. Syslinux is not the only Replinux. And the engine keyboard. This was a very important feature because the default is Belgian keyboard and the German is there. So you can easily change the. So actually, the debugger is on here as well. Recovery is possible. We also have a small DOS image with some DOS drivers for instructing hardware to. I think it's for disabling the PC on external network interface cards. It was 6 seconds, otherwise it takes, I don't know, 30 seconds per nick, and you cannot disable it unless you run this tool. You have to manually disable it, of course. Okay, so before I make a fool of myself, let's stop the. Do you go to the full screen? Does anyone know? It's right on control? Ah, yeah, thank you. I should add virtual box. Full screen. So I think we can conclude the presentation. Let me see if I prepare something else. More information. I googled it. There's not that much information about initial numbers because it's simple. It's very simple. I mean, it does two things. It's being called and then it runs slash init and you can create them with CPIO and you have to compress them. But that's it. And so there's not much information. I think every distribution has a page that explains what tool you have to use to create your own initial numbers for your distribution. But of course, that's less interesting. It's more interesting to have some tools that automatically use to for you. And I'm sure that, like the Axa debug, which is a simple tool, it's written in Python. I did it in Python because it was very easy to write it and it works. But I can imagine that there are simple things you want to write to automate something or put something in workflow that you want to load from Budo as fast as possible so you don't have to create a live CD that's maybe 200 megabytes big. If this one, I don't know how big it was, I should check. So, Google is your friend. Although that's not true anymore. Right? Google is more and more. I don't know. Okay, so that's it. This is it. If you have questions, are there any questions? No questions? Come on, Leo. Didn't prepare a question. That's a good question. Google is your friend. No, I don't think there is actually. I think there was. You know, it is that you could specify, so I don't think there is. I don't think. I never tried it, though. I did try it. I did the CentOS. So I think you can go to it depends on your RAM, I'm sure. Yeah, of course, 4 gigabytes, come on. Oh, it has 4 gigabytes, let me that has how many? Okay, just kidding. Anyone? course, I think I can upload it. Frozen size with the previous was like that. And also to actually, what I do for presentations, I say, I'm not going to make it, I don't have time to do it. And I say, let's say that I'm going to make this presentation in Frozen, and I have a deadline, and I have to do it. Of course, I do it the day before, but I have a deadline. For me, present was just the same, although we had some made something, that we could show something, it was not a final product, although we want to have a final product. So to get me going, I need a deadline, and I do something before it. So I can give the shell script. It's not rocket science. You can get the shell script, could upload it as well. But it's not finished. It's not like, I would like to finish it. I would like to write in Python, because then it's a little bit, I like more than shell script. You can make some special tips, because I guess you want to have plugins as well. Special plugins to say I want to enable BusyBox or not enable BusyBox, or to automatically detect Debian and it would use Debian specific server, something like that. There are lots of nice things you can do with it if you have the time. So I will make the problem. No problem. So okay, that's it. So the first presentation, I've written a lot of time.